Well, love from love, hope from hope, and peace from peace. Welcome to the everlasting gospel of Revelation 14, foretold to come in this hour. And it's time to focus upon love. The angel in all of us. Praise the Lord. Kick back, enjoy, please share. It's time for love to burn this earth down. Get ready, it's going to be a good one. And don't miss the next one either. If you snooze, you will lose. Blessing of Kenny G. So it came to pass when Christ was teaching others at a young age, 12, almost as an afterthought, Jesus suddenly went on to tell them that God gives every soul all truth as a ladder with many steps for the salvation and for the perfection of their constantly needy souls. And Yeshua also pointed out that the very same truth, which seems most truthful today, many wise souls shall end up abandoning for the higher truth of tomorrow as they press on towards the perfection that he has brought forth in his kingdom age covenant that ends religion. Jeremiah 31:35 says, "And I am the Lord God, and now no one else needs to be taught about me anymore." He's inviting ignorance now about him, if you will believe my message from him, that he has always been unconditional love. But before Jesus left and quit teaching at the temple, he then unexpectedly urged all of them that were there, and there was at least a dozen, to receive all truth according to the amount of light and ability that they have to understand such truth. For the truth shall set us free. God's people have always been destroyed by lack of knowledge. Hosea 4:6. And Emmanuel, our God with us again soon, shall come to his temple, as Malachi foretold. He asserted that people should never persecute anyone receiving the same truth with a different view, Christians versus Islam. Stop it. In the mighty name of love. For truth is the might of God and the name of God, and it shall always prevail in the end over any and all errors. And that lion and the lamb, a roaring lion of Zion, who arises in the splendor of his magnificence. His glory goes before him, people. His radiance of his honor is... My God, it's going to cover this earth like water's covering the sea, like sand's covering the deserts, lilies covering the ponds, snow covering the highest tips of the mountains. His glory shall consume this earth, and he has cast his fire of love down upon earth to burn it all down. Good thing. And he additionally said that the holy law is easy for all people to understand, for it is always most just and very good. Accordingly, the master of all then urged every single person to observe those things for the salvation of their souls. Cast not away truth, he was saying. So he was growing in wisdom and might, 12 years old. As a teenager, the Lord shined bright Jesus was then constantly spreading much good cheer everywhere he went, for he was full of grace's truth, overflowingly. Nor did any of his associates ever cease to wonder at the gracious words of love flowing out of him and peacefulness. And it's also truth that people can cultivate gracefulness, but graciousness is like an aroma of friendliness which always emanates from any love-saturated soul. And that was he. He was just like a sponge. He had soaked in so much love, and he was just at peace with himself and the world around him. And above all other traits that clearly describes that youthful son of charity, his love for his fellow man, everyone around him, was always very enthusiastic and always most contagious. Just being around him, his passion, you caught his passion. Jesus was attractive in his own way, and he had a rugged handsomeness to himself. And as he grew tall and became a man, that future keeper of his flocks was then becoming very muscular, well-shaped, real slender, and most appealing even to the maiden's eyes. Even his long streaming locks, because he was a Nazarene, that was a religious rite that was recognized. That's why I have this wig. I'm going to write a book. How do you, how I grew my own wig. This is my hair. And I had it cut last summer because it got too hot. But I had it longer than when I was a teenager. I grew it for about three years. Even his long streaming locks were fine looking in every way. For his under the shoulder length hair was of golden brown shade that could never be matched. And as the master walked, it gracefully fell into some gentle, soft curls that, and his hair always waved about very agreeably as they laid across his masculine broad back. Even as a youth, Jesus was well respected by everyone that he met along the dusty roads of life, for his ways of God's goodness always went before him without him putting out any effort at all. And it was therefore a real sure bet that he could have written a book about goodness, since he saw traits of such in many, many forms, some sincere and others not. So it was easy to see, though, that his goodness always compelled much respect to keep flowing his way. That's, he was putting out good stuff and he was getting good stuff back. We get what we expect. If you expect doom and gloom, that's what you're going to get. And he wasn't devoid of any grace, like a multitude of hypocrites who only gave alms just to be seen of men. And it was also truth that Yeshua really understood men and women deeply with their problems. And he was empathetic. He wasn't just sympathetic, he was empathetic. Furthermore, that son of Joseph and Mary could easily let his genuine sympathy to shine forth as he showed some sincere compassion unto anyone that experienced any troubles in their lives. But he seldom indulged in any pity. Some things are more to be censored than pitied. And he wasn't much about censoring people. He just loved them where they were at. For in spite of the Lord's compassion being boundless, it wasn't too hard to see that his sympathy was practical, personal, and constructive, so that he could be very good at helping people to help themselves. And he was becoming very effective in ministry. Moreover, his familiarity with suffering never bred any indifference within him, and he was effectively able to minister to countless distressed souls without increasing their self-pity at all. He was not condescending. He was not looking down upon anyone. And that is where we all need to get to the place where we will stop looking down on others around us. That is this ministry. So Trudy and I thank you for sharing and liking and spreading this word of love. We are the olive trees of the north, Isaiah 41. Read that scripture. But just as the sun shined in the daytime, it would also soon become obvious, very clear, that Jesus would be able to help men in some very miraculous ways, because he sincerely loved everybody so much. And he truly loved each man, every woman, and every child as much as he loved life itself. And he loved others as he loved himself. He preached what he knew. I'm preaching what I know. Therefore, he was fated to become a true friend unto multitudes because of his remarkable insights. And nor was it ever any secret, even as a boy, that he knew what was within people's hearts and minds. He just knew. Neither was it ever too surprising that some whispers often came forth after some astounded souls believed that he really had read their minds. He had a good discernment about himself. I have the same thing. He had fantastic people skills. But the real truth was that Jesus was an interested and a keen observer. He was generally interested in everyone. And he was always preordained to be an expert in comprehending the needs of man. Consequently, he would always be very clever in detecting human longings. He knew what we wanted. And the greatest thing setting our Savior of the generations apart from most other young people, because he was still really young, was that he deeply believed that following the Lord God has always been the beginning of wisdom. And he also understood that knowledge of that Holy One always brings forth great understanding. For by understanding the Most High, a man's days shall be multiplied, and his life shall even be increased eternally. Furthermore, Isa Yeshua Jesus knew that all wisdom comes from our Heavenly Father and is with him forever. And Isa Yeshua Jesus therefore well understood that anyone without wisdom always follows some empty words of nonsense, like someone who says, "Awake unto some sleeping wood," or say, "Arise unto a dumb stone." Only a fool would do such. Common sense was Christ's purest language. So in the same way, Emmanuel also realized that a boy's deeds could become harmful if he playfully swings his father's sword without knowing about its razor-sharp edge and ignorance. So it's not treated just as a toy. He was wise. But at the same time, he easily comprehended that the crown of wisdom always makes peace and perfect health to flourish wildly, which are among the very best gifts of God. And lastly, due to Jesus learning good ethics from Joseph, Yeshua additionally realized that God teaches anyone with a mind to understand that the honest work of humble hands is like a daily prayer of thanksgiving. We gotta keep that thanksgiving gratefulness alive, because that keeps our love alive. And he well knew that the music of the plow is a real joyful song unto the Lord. But he also saw that he who eats of the bread of idleness must end up dying in hunger. For a field of stones can only yield stones alone. Yeshua was greatly esteemed As a young man, Jesus was popular. By the time he was only 20 years old, that celestial-looking hair of that Lion of Zion was the bravest badge of courage, as all Nazarenes took pride in, due to their special vow of pushing aside any sharp razors as a pure religious sacrament. Samson was a Nazarene, and that's why he grew his hair long. It was the same thing for Jesus. And that's why I wear this long hair, to celebrate that. And as his long flowing mane was always neatly parted upon the crown of his head, down its center, but as it ran down its face like a gentle stream, his high and imposing forehead was usually well covered. So there was a prophecy of Noah found in the book of Enoch, and that was fulfilled. For Christ's small diamond-shaped birthmark was hidden on his forehead, just as Noah foretold when he prophesied this. And this is from the book. The Ancient of Days shall wear a birthmark of reddish color, the shape of a lentil, upon his face. And small birthmarks will also be on his thighs. And after 2 very short years, he will amazingly know how to distinguish one good thing from another in his heart. And Noah foretold that Jesus' discernment would be most sharp. And in his youth, that Messiah would be like an uneducated man who knows nothing of some earthly things, until the time he finally knows the 3 books of Genesis, Exodus, and Leviticus. And by that time that he was 20, he knew those books like the back of his hand. And then Noah said he will acquire much wisdom quickly, and he'll learn to thrive with great understanding. Then some wise seers shall humbly come unto him and drop unto their knees, to his knees, and with the blessed lineage of his father and of his ancestors, King David, the unbelief of his very own brothers will hurt him very bad. See, a prophet has no honors in his own house. And there were times when Jesus' brothers and sisters, they ridiculed and mocked and did not believe him. He was just a brother, nothing special. For the same reason, I've lost my whole family, all my children and my wife, all my friends, because I burn passionately for love. A prophet has no honor in his own home. And a prophet seldom has any honor in his own home. But counsel and prudence, Noah said, will always be with him, and he will come to know the most hidden secrets of man. For all things shall be revealed, Noah prophesied of the Messiah. And it shall come to pass that his crowning wisdom will reach all peoples of the entire earth, and he alone will know all of the secrets of the living and all of the designs of the unfaithful. Against him will come to nothing. All against him, they will not prosper until his death. And after his return, his most gracious rule over the living will be more than great, as his peace reigns in the kingdom age that I am bringing. Then shall his lofty designs of the kingdoms of love, peace, and joy become as a great brilliance, and his blinding light will then succeed a millionfold in destroying the rest of earth's darkest darkness. He is the rising sun of love, who is going to destroy all the gross darkness of man-made religion, as Isaiah 60 foretold. For he is the everlasting elect of God, who shall shine evermore as the sign of righteousness. And then the breath of his Holy Spirit and his unending design of the ages shall be forever and evermore, prophesied Noah. Look it up. I did. And just as Noah's prophecy suggested, by the time our Lord's teenage years were finally behind him, he stood as a nobleman who would never be double-minded or double-tongued. For he always walked in the successful light of his blazing Father of lights of love. Therefore, Jesus Christ was fated to never be unsuccessful due to him being of firm purpose. For he refused to ever be fickle or to be naive, a naive follower of others that always yields unto impulses. And as a result of his upbringing as a Nazarene, with perfection as his middle name, our Prince of Peaceful Purposes was never satisfied with any imperfection, which in turn caused Jesus to always be extremely hard-working and very fond of anything that glorified God greatly. Nor was he ever in any hurry at all, since he was continually determined not to be anxious in anything that he did. So he was always well received as a young man, and he always made his friends feel at ease, very much so, since he was always he was a charming listener. That was one of his biggest things. He listened to our problems and to others' problems. For he was never engaged in the meddlesome probing of the souls of anyone, you know, sticking his nose in where he was just a concerned, loving person. And because his personality then defined the definition of divine, he was always able to comfort some hungry souls as he ministered deeply unto their thirsty souls. And it was a sure bet as well that Jesus could never find any searching soul who would ever object to him explaining that a share of glory, of God's glory, is always set apart for all righteous children of his love by our fathers of light as their inheritance. Not according to everything that each person is, but according to everything that they shall be. For he has never seen any of us as we are, but as we shall be. The second we go into glory, we are as sinless as the day that we are born. And for that reason, it is true that those who walk with the Spirit of love are under no condemnation if you have your love light on. Only those committing blasphemy of the Holy Spirit commit spiritual suicide. So Jesus saw the wise seeking his riches of the treasure of his excellence. And more than ever, just before our eventual fisher of men finally turned 19, he received a deep into his soul aflame with love divine, that a person's eyes are the windows of the soul, and that men and women should all therefore seek the Father of lights with all of their hearts, and pray that he would send forth his earthly light of love, his light of lights, to burn off any cataracts that anyone might have. And nor did that son of determination doubt at all that it would become his job alone to shine upon their lights the truth of love, so that no people would ever again be a respecter of any man. Because that is what is to become one with God. So that they could become as clear and as bright as the brightness of the sun. Their eyes can open and be like the sun shining upon the sky. For the Lord then already at that young age already held an inner witness that by that time that he was God's brightest star of stars. And then came John the Baptist. Christ admired John the Baptist greatly, muchly so. Said there was never a a more important prophet. And I believe it. The Son of Man never looked up to anyone more than his cousin John, who was called the Baptist, for he began boldly preaching the truth at an early age that whosoever is born of God does not easily commit sin, for the seed of the Almighty remains in him, and the spirit of such a one cannot commit sin. No spirit. It's our soul that is bad. The flesh is weak, even if the spirit is strong. But he stressed as well that God always knows the weakness of all flesh. And then he noted that if anyone is undisciplined, they can't help falling into sin. If you're not disciplined, everyone, it's going to happen. For the spirit of an enlightened soul is like unbendable steel and cannot be moved, while the flesh is like a real weak reed blowing in the wind, which is easily bent by any old wind that comes along. And John additionally taught that many multitudes, he taught many people, multitudes, that a war within always rages within anyone who has been enlightened. Muhammad said there is no greater jihad than to fight against the evil within. Peace and blessing upon Muhammad. And the flesh also desires to dominate any soul, he preached. For without the soul, the body does not sin. Just as the soul is never able to be saved without the spirit. But John also told the gospel truth, that if the soul is saved when it is without evil, the spirit is saved. Then the body finally becomes free from sin. And Christ's cousin continually stressed that the light of God then lovingly illuminates their spirit. And Jesus, he knew, was the unequal light of God. And Emmanuel also realized as well that has his eternal light then raises the soul of someone saved. But in the end, it's always the sinful darkness of any created flesh that causes such a supernatural light to start diminishing. And lastly, that cousin of his who cried out, "Repent," in the wilderness, he was always careful to teach the multitudes that there was one coming after him, Isa, Yeshua, Jesus, the Word of God, the living Master of all, that he would possess the great light that would be so bright that all the world would someday bathe in within his brightness. And he warned the souls without his light that they would stay in darkness until everlasting eternity never ends. And in the end of that reality, we can perish if we let our love light go out. Unforgivable sin. And John was heralding such a blinding salvation. And he also knew that he had a great responsibility in announcing God's coming Lamb, who was always predestined to allow his very own blood to be shed for the redemption of all. For it was written by the prophets that there is no, without the shedding of blood, remission of sins. For the mouth of God long ago declared through Moses the prophet. And by the way, why do you think there was human sacrifices? Because of people all around the world got wind that there must be shedding of blood to appease God. This was not just a Hebrew thing. That was a worldwide thing. It was happening in all over the world. And it was misunderstanding of what God wanted in a way, but in a way it was not. So that's another, that's a sermon unto its own self. But praise the Lord that God is good. And I lost my place here. And so he preached as he went. He continually thundered away John in the power of the Holy Spirit as he preached God's best blessings, and he warned multitudes about his worst judgments, God's worst judgments over those that wouldn't fear him with a respectful kind of fear. And as a result, the fame of John then caused a mighty stir all throughout Palestine as countless travelers spread the news about his intense preaching. He was most passionate. And by the time the Lord's season to come forth finally neared, it was already predestined that only 15 months would end up passing between the time John first started baptizing great crowds and the unfortunate day of his arrest and imprisonment. That wasn't a long time. 15 months. 15 months was his oomph of his ministry. 15 months. And that helped change Israel's hearts to prepare the way of the Lord. Malachi 3:1, the first time. That's a dual prophecy. It's more for the second time. And I'm the second messenger. There was a precedent set that John the Baptist did not return the original Elijah did not return. John the Baptist came. John even denied that he was Elijah. I don't. I am the latter-day Daniel of Daniel 12:13. If I'm stumbling in my words, I am alcoholic. I've had about three or four shots. No, five or six shots by now. But I'm the one whose eyes are dull and red of wine, even though I've been transgressed by wine. Habakkuk 2 foretold that the just will live by my faith. Because it's not my faith, it's by the faith of all prophecy. I stand by it. Do you? Love from love, hope from hope. Until next time. Come on back. You ain't gonna believe what's coming next.